Scripture reading today is found in Isaiah 52, verse 7. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 7. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publisheth peace, that bringeth good tidings of good, that publisheth salvation, that saith unto Zion, Thy God reigneth. Anyone got an idea what this verse is talking about? Apostles? Bringing the gospel message. And the Bible describes the work of these people as beautiful. Or they have beautiful feet. This is the canvases in particular? Okay, maybe. I want to ask, what is our purpose here today? Why are we here?
To bring souls to Christ.
To worship the Lord and to bring souls to Christ. Absolutely. Does anyone have the memory verse, Matthew 28, 19, 20, memorized? To how many people? Okay. Amen. Amen. So that's the purpose of our existence, is to preach the gospel unto those who don't know Jesus. Now, I just want to get into a little bit today about how we do that, and specifically how we do it through canvassing. What's an example of Paul's method of teaching the gospel? Does anyone know?
Practical,
but there is an example. Let's turn in our Bibles to Acts chapter 20, verse 20. How did Paul preach the gospel? We understand there's a variety of ways, but I just want to give let's look at one particular instance. Acts chapter 20, verse 20. The Bible says, And how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you, and have taught you publicly, and from house to house. So how did Paul teach?
Door to door.
And also it says there publicly. So we've got public meetings, and door to door. Now we could take this door to door, it might be Bible studies, right, at your home? Also might be canvassing. Well, let's look. How did the disciples preach the gospel in Matthew chapter 10, verse 12? Matthew chapter 10, verse 12. Brother Nicola, if you could read that for us. Actually, I'm just going to get you to read a little bit more. If you could read verses 5 through to 12, if that's alright.
Matthew 10, 5 to 12.
Yes, please, sir.
These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, Go to any city of the Samaritans, enter you not. And as you go,
Thank you, sir. So, what method can we just get from this passage? What method did Jesus send the 12 disciples on? Like, what was the method that he used? Door to door. When you come to an house, salute it. So he's saying, I'm going to send you into these cities, and you're going to go from house to house when you come to an house. He did say, I don't think we need to get into it too much. He did say, go there unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Don't go unto the Gentiles, brother. Okay, so Sam saying there's a particular reason why Jesus said to the disciples, only go to the house of Israel. Now, what does it say in Matthew 20? Oh, 28, go to all the nations, and even in the Mark, what's the gospel commission there? In Mark. All the world at to every creature, right? Yeah, so it's, we're not limited anymore. We can go, actually, let's turn to Acts chapter 1. Where will we go? Where will God send us if we're faithful to his calling? Acts chapter 1, verse 8. This, oh man, I was at camp meeting, and this really inspired me when a preacher showed me this one. It's really fun. The youth should love it. So we're going to Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Okay, notice he said before, tarry ye here in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Now, watch what he says when this happens. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea. Okay, let's just look at this briefly. To the disciples, if we're going to translate this into our day, where's Jerusalem? No, I'm saying like, as you as Australians, or as you as Melbourneites, or whatever.
No, Jerusalem
is Israel. Okay. I'm going to put it to you. The equivalent of Jerusalem, because it's in the country of Israel. So the city of Jerusalem is Melbourne, the equivalent. Where might Judea be then? Judea is the whole region.
Victoria.
Okay, we can say Victoria. Some people might say Australia. Where might Samaria be?
Where are we?
Now this is, remember, is Samaria part of Palestine?
Asia.
Okay. We're just going to say here.
Asia.
We're going to say here. All of Australia. Yes. Literally Samaria, but the equivalent today, if we're going to put these into Australian terms, Australia, and into other parts, well, that's the same, isn't it? All the earth. So God does not promise. He says, if you'll be faithful in being his witness, he's going to send you to people in Melbourne. He's going to send you to Werribee. He's going to send you to your families, your homes, your workmates. If you're faithful, he's not even going to preach the word in Melbourne. He's going to preach it all over Victoria. You're going to be missionaries all over Victoria. And if you're faithful there, he's not even going to use you or your people in Victoria. He's going to use you. You're going to win the whole Australia. You know, there's places in Australia, we don't know anybody in there. But Jesus says he's going to send you. And if you're faithful to go into all of Australia, he's going to send you right around the world. So you youth, you should be looking to do work in God's service, because he will send you right around the world for him. He promised. So that really inspired me. And look, I've been a missionary in Kaitaia. Then I was a missionary in the North Island. And then God sent me to Australia. So I'm already on the way. So I'm saying it's a promise of God. He's going to use you if you're faithful. Now, I want to talk about a few things. This is just the promise, but what is important? We're talking about canvassing, so we're going to, in order to be effective canvassers, there's something we must do. We must not neglect, absolutely not neglect. And we're going to look at it. We'll find it in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 13 to 15. What must we not neglect? The most important of all. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 13 to 15. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 13 to 15. Would you like to read that for us, Brother Jeff?
Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace.
Okay, so what are the few things in there that we had? Take on the whole armor of God. So you need the whole armor, right? So So what are the, what's the armor? Okay, you got the breastplate of righteousness. What else? Shield of faith. Yep, what else? Okay, so I just want to, verse 15 there, shield of righteousness, verse 15 there, this is what I want to focus on. All these things are important, but one that's absolutely essential and necessary is preparation. That's correct. That's correct. Yeah. So you got to take on the whole armor, but I want to focus on a very, 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 very important one, and that's preparation. And we're not just talking about, you know, I've got to buy the books and I've got to, you know, learn my canvas. We're not just talking about that sort of preparation. We're talking about spiritual preparation. If we try and go out there unconverted, these things aren't going to happen. Now, I'd just like to see the danger of being unprepared to start with, just to... Don't want to get negative, but let's go to 2 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 14. What is the danger of being unprepared? 2 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 14. 2 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 14. Have you got that, brother? Okay.
And he did evil because he prepared not his heart to seek the Lord.
Okay, so this is talking about, is it Jeroboam or Rehoboam? Yeah, Rehoboam. He didn't prepare his heart to seek the Lord, and what happened? What was the result of not preparing? He did evil. So he did not only do an ineffective task, he did worse than that. He did an evil task because he didn't prepare himself. We think of a surgeon, okay? So a surgeon has to inject you. I don't know the exact quantities, but say he had to inject you with 60 mils of anesthetic. Now, if he hadn't prepared himself through study and through understanding, what if he gave you, I'll give you 120, you know, it could kill you because he wasn't prepared. Or if he gives you 30, you wake up halfway through the operation. The sore's going through your rib cage, and you wake up. It's dangerous to be unprepared. If you didn't have to get a driver's license, if you just jumped in the car and hopped on the M80, we'd never get home. It's so important to be prepared. Now, what type of preparation are we talking about? Okay, let's get through them. Preparation. Brother Jeff said spiritual. Oh, I spelled that wrong. Spiritual. Sister Lucy, you said training, which is pretty much practical. What else? There's one more. Huh?
Biblical.
Pardon me?
Biblical.
Biblical, right. Well, we'll call that intellectual or mental or whatever you want to say. We'll call it mental as
knowledge.
Knowledge, yeah. So it's a shorter word, so that's right. Mental preparation. We're going to talk about those three. Spiritual preparation. Obviously, number one, that's the key. What should be our prayer? To start with spiritual preparation, we know we have to pray. What should be our most earnest prayer every day, and not for only for ourselves, but for others? Let's just turn to this example in Philemon, verse 6. Now, I might have a bit of trouble finding this. Philemon. Verse 6. Now this is the prayer of Paul for the believers, but I think we should really take it on board as our prayer also. And what did he pray? Sister Alita, can you read verse 6?
That the communication of our faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus.
Okay, so we have to pray that the communication of our faith, in other words, the witnessing that we're going to do, may be effectual. Without prayer, we're wasting our time and wasting people's time. We must pray for God's help and God's blessing on our work. Now, talking about spiritual preparation, being converted, praying, why is this important? Why do I know we've said if we're not prepared, we're going to do evil work. So what's the sort? What's evil about not being spiritually prepared when we go door to door or when we do any sort of witnessing?
It's the difference between saying something by rote and meaning something with saying something with conviction.
Absolutely. What else? What else?
We'll become ineffective for Christ.
We're going to be ineffective. Brother Sam. Amen. Yeah. Also, there's an interesting verse in Proverbs chapter 27. All those are very, very good answers. Proverbs chapter 27, verse 19. If we're not prepared spiritually, if we have cherished sin in our life, if we haven't committed it or consecrated ourselves to God for that day, what can be the issue there? Proverbs chapter 27, verse 19. I'll just read it. It says, as in water, face answereth to face, so the heart of man to man. So what does this mean? What does it mean, as in water, face answereth to face? It's like looking into a mirror. You see your own face, right? When you look into the water.
It also means the personal contact.
Okay. So as in water, face answereth to face. You see your own face, so the heart of man to man. We certainly can, but I'm saying, I'm looking at Brother Nicola here. I can see his face. Physically, I can see his face. He can see mine. Do you know what else is happening? On an unconscious level, he knows my heart, and I know his heart. On an unconscious level. If we're not converted, people will know. They might not be apparent to them, and they might not know why they feel funny during this visit or something, but they will know. If you have cherished sin, they will know. That's what the Bible says. The heart knows the heart. Heart of man to man. So it's so important, because if we come up there and we have this this negative feeling in ourselves, like we have a guilt towards God, and when we're trying to preach forgiveness to someone else and we haven't received this forgiveness, what's the problem here? What's going to happen? Are they going to receive your message? We're talking about... We're hypocritical.
So when you
see
the person, so when you look at them, they finally mirror our image, what we've actually...
That's it.
If you go
to someone, exactly, if you go to someone and you've found peace with God, you've found the love of Jesus in your heart, and you can preach to them and you can say, look what Jesus has done for me.
In fact, you won't have to say very much because it'll show on your face.
I love it. So this is... We're talking about influence here. If you go into a door and you've got a bad influence, a bad atmosphere, it's going to influence them against the gospel. You're going to shut your, not only to shut your door to you, but to shut their door to Jesus. I'm going to go through it a little bit. There's a few steps that when we're coming to God, most people go through. Start off with, we don't know anything, right? We are ignorant of God. We're ignorant of salvation. But in our ignorance, most of the time, like there's people in other countries, all sorts of religions, they just don't know. They haven't heard. And so we call that, they're sincere. They're sincere in what they try to be good people. They're sincerely ignorant. Now we want to bring them out of this though, because there's no salvation being sincerely ignorant. Okay, yeah, that's another study. But if we have an evil influence, we can turn this from sincerely ignorant to insincerely ignorant. Now they've heard the truth. They're not ignorant anymore, but they don't want to know it. They've shut their ears to knowing it, and they might have heard it, and then they've rejected it. And they class themselves as not knowing it. That's insincere, and now that's a very, very dangerous place to be in. Very dangerous, because not only do you not know...
It's willful. They tend to also turn around and start
calling
people against
them. That's it. Now they're going to influence other people to be insincerely ignorant. It is so dangerous. So what we want to do, you don't want to bring a person to ignorance. You want to bring a person to
knowledge.
And if we bring a person to knowledge, and if they've found Christ, really found him in their heart, they're going to bring other people. And that's the beauty of the gospel. That's how the gospel spreads. Okay. I just want to read a quote here. This is there's a textbook for canvassing. If you might know it. It's called Cole Porter Ministry. It's the most amazing book to read if you want to go door to door. And just on page 57 of that book, every soul is surrounded by an atmosphere of its own. An atmosphere, it may be, charged with the life-giving power of faith, courage, hope, and sweet with the fragrance of love. Or it may be heavy and chill with the gloom of discontent and selfishness, or poisonous with the deadly taint of cherished sin. By the atmosphere surrounding us, every person with whom we come in contact is consciously or unconsciously affected. So we have to remember, no matter who we're talking to, they're unconsciously or consciously affected by the influence that we have. Now, the beauty of it is, if we have something in our life that we might, we're worried about, might make a bad influence or might poison our atmosphere, it only takes one prayer to be right with God, and that's the beauty of it. You know, we don't, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. One prayer is all we need to be right with God. And I'll tell you, if we do that and we're faithful, God will really, really bless our work. Now the work that we're going to do, that's spiritual preparation. That's just the importance of spiritual preparation. But I want to get into a little bit about these other ones. I'm going to rub all this out. We don't need it. Practical preparation, or how we go about it, it's got a huge, 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 huge topic. But we just want to talk about a couple of things, and that's our attitude. I want to ask you, do you know in the Bible where Jesus said, Paul actually said, but the Holy Spirit through Paul said he had joy because of something. Do you know what that joy was? He said, my joy is the... Close. Let's turn there. 2 Corinthians 2:3. What gave Paul or the Holy Spirit joy? 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 3. I say Holy Spirit because you know in 3 John verse 2 that it says, Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. Who's speaking there? John's actually writing, but who's he representing? Christ. Christ desires you to be in good health. So Paul's writing here, but just remember, he's representing God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 3, what gives God joy? Can you read that for us, please, Brother Laverne? Chapter 2, verse 3.
It says, and I wrote this saying unto them, lest when I came, I should have sorrow from them of whom I ought to rejoice, having confidence in you all, that my joy is the joy of you all.
So what's Paul's or God's joy? Our joy. So it says, my joy is the joy of you all. Isn't that awesome? God is happy when we are happy. Now, if we can take the same principle, when we're canvassing, if we're happy, what's going to happen to other people?
We're going to rub off.
We're going to pass off. It's going to happen. It's contagious. When we're happy, we make other people happy. It's a wonderful, wonderful blessing to be able to put a smile on someone's face. Now, for a start, now how does this help with canvassing? For a start, if you make people happy, how do they feel towards you?
Well, welcoming.
And they like you.
They're more open.
Yeah, they're more open. All these things. People like happy people. They do. We all do. I love happy people. And if people like you, then I tell you, your job's, you're pretty much a third of the way there already. Before even speaking, you're a third of the way through your canvas. So how do you make people happy? How can you show that you're happy?
Being happy yourself.
You've got to be happy, but how do you show that?
On your face.
Put a smile on. You know, there's a there was a canvasser in the SDA church, and he was going around, and he had terrible sales. You know, he'd do 7-8 hours a day, just really, he had really hit the job. He was very, very, very determined. He was making terrible sales. So one day, the canvassing leader came to him, and he says, look, we've got to sit down, we've got to have a conversation. He says, I know what your problem is. You're not happy. You're going down there, you're going like you're I don't want to say it, but like your big long face, like your dog just died or something, you know? People aren't going to buy all that. So he said, but the man says, well, this is just who I am. I don't naturally just smile. This is just my face. Well, he says, I don't care what you're born with. You, even if you're not feeling like smiling, smile. Force yourself. Smile. And see what the results, and you know what the results were? His sales just skyrocketed. He was so, so effective just by this one technique, smiling. You know, people, when they're sitting in their houses, and they're seeing these people walk down the street coming, oh, here comes some people coming to my door. Uh-oh, they're going to the neighbors. Oh, well, they're only one house away. And they see you, you're wearing a big smile on your face, and you're walking down, you're happy, and you're singing psalms or whatever you're doing. You know what they're thinking now? Oh, I'm not so prejudiced against this person anymore. I want to know what he's happy about. What's going on in his life? I want some of that. Okay, so if we're happy, even when we're walking, even when we're in the car, people are watching. So that's we really got to make the effort. Even if we don't feel like smiling, force yourself. Train yourself. Thank you. Yes. You know what? The physiological relation between your body and your brain, if you force yourself to smile, even when you're not happy, eventually you're going to start feeling happy. Yes, brother?
There are less muscles required in your facial expression to smile than there are to frown.
There you go. So you're saving calories by smiling. Yeah. Great. You do that by walking. Okay. The second, that's cheerfulness. We've got to be cheerful. No, that's for me, I don't really... Like, it's important to know your canvas, important to be effective, but if you're cheerful, I mean, that's a huge part of the job done. You've got to be cheerful. And then the second one, guess what the second one is? Starts with C again, and it's just as important, almost as important.
Confidence.
Confidence?
Yeah, confidence.
Confidence is very important. Convicted is very important. So I'm making a bit vague what I'm looking for, but it sort of relates, and it's called courtesy. There's a little poem, and it goes like this. Hearts, like doors, are opened with tiny, tiny keys. Now, two of these are, thank you, miss, and if you please, and if you please where you go, you will go where you please. It's very important to be, it's two words. You just come up to the door, and you, thank you and please. It makes such a difference. Now, it's not hard, but most of us, when we first start out, we're just going up there, hey, I've got a book and I want to give it to you and look, I've got all these great things to say about it and will you pay me for it? But if you go up there and you're saying, hi, miss, I love your garden, you know, it's such a great day today. And how are you doing anyway? You look happy. Why are you happy? Let's look, see what the Bible says about courtesy. I'm going to stop talking. What is courtesy? Let's turn to, okay, I can't find it now. Philippians chapter 2. Yes, sir. Philippians chapter 2, verse 4. The key to courtesy. How do we get this nice nature that we can bless others? Philippians chapter 2, verse 4. Sister Lucy, would you be able to read that for us? What is courtesy? The Bible definition of courtesy. To me, anyway. Philippians chapter 2, verse 4.
Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians.
Yes. This is a good Bible.
Philippians chapter 2, verse 4.
Yep.
Thank you.
Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others.
Right, okay. So that's pretty interesting. That's pretty obvious, isn't it? When we're being courteous, we're looking after other people. We're looking after their feelings. We're looking after their... Now, we don't want to wound their pride. We don't want to come across like we're trying to teach them something and they're dumb. No, they're ignorant. They need to learn something from me. We're not there we're there to respect their feelings. That's the main thing.
Can I go back to verse 3?
Yeah, okay.
It says here that let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. That is the root of courtesy.
Beautiful, beautiful. Lowliness of mind. Yeah. Humility. That everyone esteem other better than themselves. Okay. And we do that when we really have this attitude that, you know, God loves this person just as much as he loves me. Jesus died for this person. No, he loves them to death. When we have that understanding, then we're going to look after them, you know. We're going to look after their feelings. We're going to try and make them feel relaxed, comfortable, all these sort of things. It's going to be natural to us. I just want to read, again, from Colporter Ministry. What does courtesy do for us in regards to canvassing? This is a beautiful one. Page 73. A kind, courteous Christian is the most powerful argument that can be produced in favor of Christianity. Huh? Isn't that amazing? It's not all the theory in the world. Isn't going to help. It's the kind, courteous Christian. That's the most powerful favor in representing Christ and delivering the truth to somebody else. All right, so that's attitude preparation. We're going to do practical preparation when we go to the task, but the last one I want to do is mental preparation. Now, Sister Lucy mentioned it. We know it's knowledge. Knowledge about what? Good. So you've got to know your product. So, say we're going to give a book, what should we do?
Read it.
Read it? Okay. What else should we have knowledge about?
The author.
Yeah, okay. That includes the author. What else?
Knowledge about the people we're going to.
Beautiful. Knowledge about the people, their needs. Wonderful. Can't go offering, what's the old say? Sell ice to an Eskimo or something like that? Yeah. Got to know their needs, find their needs and reach out to that. What else do we need to know? Someone said Bible before. In 1 Peter 3:15, can we turn there please? For what? For what?
For the hope that you have within you.
Okay, let's read it. Beautiful. Don't even need Bibles. Well, okay, I shouldn't say that. We have got Bibles in your heads and in your hearts if you're diligent in memorizing it. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. Sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. So we have to know where we stand on the Bible. What I believe in. We have to know this. Because if people ask us and we can't give them an answer, or we give them an answer that they see is not a very good answer, our influence is lost. You know, we're not credible anymore. Yes?
We all need to be in tune with each other.
Mm. That's it. We have to be totally on the same page in harmony. Absolutely. Yeah.
Christ.
Okay.
Because if you don't have that product, where Christ is the product that you're introducing, and if you don't know him, and if you don't understand him, you can't meet anybody.
Very good.
And you don't have any knowledge to him.
We need to be converted.
Very good.
I've studied a little bit of sales, and if you want to get through to somebody and sell something, you need to do about less than 30% talking, more than 70% listening.
Love it.
Because you need to build rapport with them. And that comes through your mental preparation of knowing your Bible, knowing your product, knowing all that sort of stuff, will end up giving you the ability to listen to their needs and be able to share with them. It's no point going to them, hey, listen, you need this, you need this, you need this, because you don't know what they need. That's your opinion.
Beautiful.
But when they know what they need and they tell you that and you're able to listen, then they sell the products to themselves. You don't have to sell a thing.
Absolutely, that's very important. The thing is, like tomorrow we're going to start out with the health books. We're not even going to do spiritual books straight off. We're just going to do health books.
It's an entering wedge anyway.
It's an entering wedge. But what we want to do, we want to bless people in their homes. You know, it's not all about bringing them to church. It is, and ultimately it's about bringing them to Christ. But we also want to help them in their health. We want to help them in their families. We want to help them raise their children. We want, that's all in people's needs. So, but to do that, what we want to do, we want to bring them to Christ, ultimately. But we can't start off with, you know, you need Jesus, because they don't know that. But if we minister to them with the health, on the health side of things, while we're ministering, we're showing them the books, we're going to be listening to them, and we're going to discern where they are in their spirituality. Are they ready for me to, you know, offer them a Desire of Ages? Are they ready for me maybe just to offer them a prophecy course? Are they ready to offer a Steps to Christ? Just a tract, just a DVD. No, we've got to listen. That's a very good point, Brother Sam. Yes, Sister Lena?
Something on that word. When the product is good, it sells itself.
Mm.
When the product is new, but no one knows about it, you've got to give people a try.
Good. Love it. Okay.
Give people bit by bit.
Bit by bit. Okay. Now let's turn. I don't want to talk anymore. Because we've said, this is just an introduction. Tomorrow we're going to have, it's going to be really practical. There's going to be a little bit of spiritual talk, but mostly practical. We're going to memorize the canvas. We're going to learn how to present the books. And we're going to learn when to say spiritual things. So it's going to be really good. But all this preparation, we all know it. We all need to do it. It's very simple. What is going to be the result if we are well prepared in our work? What's going
to
be the result?
Glory to God.
God's glory. And what? Okay, I'm not going to ask you the question because I want the Bible to answer it. If we do bring glory to God, bring ourselves to Christ, what will be, first off, what will be our reward? Let's turn to Luke chapter 10, verse 17. Let's see what the reward was of the disciples when they went out on their mission and they came back. What reward did they have? Luke chapter 10, verse 17. Luke chapter 10 verse 27. Now 17. Now we know that you're going to be rewarded tomorrow. You're going to be able to keep the profits from the canvassing. But we're not looking at that sort of physical reward at this time. We're looking at what is the actual spiritual or. Let's just read it. Luke chapter 10 verse 17. Sister Lita. So what did they receive?
Joy.
I was doing this. Yeah, well, they received power, but through that, they received joy. That really brought them happiness. You know, I was doing this. I did it for 3 years in TEMS, full time. And some days you'd go through. It would be a dark, cloudy day. You know, and it's amazing if it's an overcast day. People are really not really receptive. If you have a bright sunny day, it's really weird. Everyone's happy and they'll receive you. But if it's a cloudy day and it might be some drizzle. And now I'm getting down, I've been walking for like 4 hours, I'm sick of it. You're getting hardly any response. You know what? I knock on that door, on the one street, might even be the last few doors I'm going to knock on. And you know what? The person there, I said, look, I'm just here to offer you this DVD. Would you be willing to take it? And you know what? I said, oh yeah, I'll be interested in that. Nah, thanks. Nah, cool. Come back next week. And you know what that does to your heart? You've been depressed this whole time, and man, you just have such a joy, like, yes, when you're walking out there, you're really praising God. You know, this is what brings true joy to the heart. Don't forget about, you know, there's so many things in the world that bring us joy, but what really brings us joy is when we do something for Christ, when we bring someone to Jesus, and we just even just in a little way, and it's so joyful. What gives Jesus joy?
Once in a
save, but specifically, we read it before. What gave Jesus joy?
Yeah, joy.
Our joy. When we bring a soul to Christ and we're just filled with this passion, like, yes! You know how Jesus is feeling right then? He's happy. He's praised praising God? He's very happy.
Happiness is contagious, brother.
Happiness is contagious. Now let's look at this. Okay, so these disciples, they came back and they were so happy about it. And they're saying, they were rejoicing. They say, Lord, look at this. The devils even are subject to us. They're so happy. And what happened with Jesus? Let's look in verse 21. How did Jesus respond to their joy? In verse 21, in that hour, Jesus rejoiced in spirit. You know, I didn't find too many times in the Bible where I could really picture Jesus as really happy. But here, on the return of the disciples, when they were filled with joy and they'd been doing his work, Jesus was happy. You know, he was very, very happy. He rejoiced in his spirit. And this, to me, is the greatest motive. You know, if we want to please the Lord who was bruised for our sins, you know, if we want to make him happy, we've got to make other people happy by getting them to know him. Okay, now, Brother Jeff, you mentioned it before. What is the effect of our, do our missionary efforts have on the entire heaven, not just Jesus? Let's turn to Luke chapter 15, verse 7. If you've been door knocking all day and you just meet one person who you bring the message to, Luke chapter 15, verse 7. Who wants to read that? Someone there?
Yep. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance.
Okay, so now can you put your minds in heaven? Christ is in heaven, God's in heaven, and they're filled with joy over your joy in bringing people to him. Now think of all the angels. How many angels are in heaven? And all these angels, they have harps, they have voices, they have praise, they have shouts of glory to God. Imagine the whole heaven resounding when you bring one soul to Christ. Can you imagine that? One second. When I was in school, I was I did all right, but I was not really interested in school. I went to the exams. There was a minimum amount of time you had to spend in the exam. It was 30 minutes. You had to be in the exam for 30 minutes. So I'd go into the exam. The old school ceilings, and they have all the little dots in the ceiling. You know, the holes in the tiles, ceiling tiles. I used to go, and I'd count one square, and all the dots in one square, and then I'd count all the squares along this side, and then all along this side, and then I'd multiply it and get the number of tiles in that section of the roof. Then I'd do the same on this section of the roof, this section of the roof, and I'd count all the dots in the whole roof. And by the time I'd done that, 29, 30 minutes, I was gone. That's how much I enjoyed school, or enjoyed the exams.
And did you put pen to paper?
I would have. Most of the exams were multi-choice, so it's just, you're going to get at least 25%. Done. Job done, you know. Count the dots. And then 30 minutes is up, I'm out. You know, and it's funny, even after this, you go through your year 12, and in New Zealand we have a year 13, because we know we need a little bit more education than Australians, we're a bit slower. So we have a year 13, and at the end of the year 13, I said, well, everyone else is going to university, I might as well go too, you know, like that's what everyone does. Looking back, if I didn't enjoy school, do you think I would have enjoyed university? No way. It wasn't my interest. It wasn't my interest. So we can think of something that we're going to do in life. You know, I want to be a builder. I want to be a doctor. I want to be a lawyer. I want to be all these things. But do you know what? In our hearts, there is only one job that will truly bring us peace, that will truly bring us joy and happiness, and that's serving God. So it doesn't matter what occupation you're doing. I don't care if you're retired, unemployed, or if you're a nurse, or a caregiver, or a teacher, or a science room technician, whatever you are, if you're doing God's work, you're going to have joy. I can guarantee it, and that's going to be the joy of your life. And so I just pray that we can all take this to heart and really seek that joy, seek the happiness which comes with winning souls to Christ, and really try and do it effectively. And I ask you and invite, if you know any, or if you yourselves want to join us tomorrow, we're going to have a great amount of joy in blessing others. So please come.